Well, good morning. We're going to celebrate this Easter Sunday. We're going to celebrate his resurrection. Let's sing today. We're going to sing about his amazing grace. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness?
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
He shakes the whole earth.
Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Amen. Who brings our chaos?
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. For me.
Amen. Amen. I hope that you are having a great Easter. We just want to give you a great time of celebration, of worship. Please enjoy this video as it reflects the Lord, what he's done for us. The video's title is Are You Amazed? I hope that you enjoy it.
It's wider, it's stronger, it's higher, it's deeper, it's wider, it's wider, it's stronger, it's stronger.
my sorrow and deaden my sin. Lost without hope and no place to begin. Your love made a way, let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began, oh, your grace, oh, your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. Released from my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. He canceled my debt. He canceled my debt, and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began, oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. It's your have made us new, now life begins with you. Our Savior displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new, now life begins with you. Of all the redeemed, yes, we're free, free forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began, oh, we're free, free forever, we're free. Come join the song of all the redeemed, yes, we're free, free forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began, when death was arrested and my life began, when death was arrested and my life began.
Well, good morning and welcome to Midway Baptist Church on a glorious Easter morning. I welcome you. I am Brother Dennis, pastor of Midway Baptist Church. This is a very different Easter. But praise God, it's the exact same Lord and Savior that we've come to worship, for He is risen. You know, these days have been very strange, and it's hard for us to be apart. Beck and I miss you, miss all of you so very much, and we look forward to being together soon. We've been preaching out of the Gospel of John on the seven statements, the I am statements that the Lord Jesus Christ declared about Himself. That I am the Son of God. I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Now this morning, we're going to be preaching on the glories of the Lord Jesus and His resurrection, but we're going to do it a bit differently. If we're not careful in America, that we've just about scaled down Easter so that it fits in a nice little Hallmark card. Got some platitudes, got some nice slogans, we say some nice words, and then we go on and we get to what's really important, and that's silliness on Easter. But I want us to look at the reality of the glories of the Lord Jesus Christ. What did He accomplish for sinners like us? By His resurrection and His life that He gives to us. If you'd be so kind, open up your Bibles to the Gospel of John, chapter 11. The Gospel of John, chapter 11. Now, the Gospel of John is unique and set up a bit different from the other three Gospels in the sense of this. That the Holy Spirit led John to record only seven miracles, and each miracle carried a unique message so that men and women, boys and girls, could be born again, so that we can come to the truth. His method, His motive was so that we would believe. Jesus did many more miracles, John said, than just those, but these carried the meaning. And also seven times Jesus declared, I am. Now what's so important about those statements? We've repeated it many times. I want you to hear me again. Who Jesus is determines what He can do. Only God can raise the dead. Only God can save a soul. I can preach a message, but I want you to hear me. Anything I can convince you to believe, somebody else will come and change your mind. It takes a voice greater than mine. It takes the conviction of the Holy Spirit who makes the Word of God come alive in our lives to bring us to a saving faith. And I pray that this morning, beloved, that that's exactly what God will do. I want us to come to this text. Now let me give you what's going to begin. It begins as a desperate day. We're going to be speaking of Jesus Christ and Lazarus. Lazarus and his resurrection as Jesus brought him up from the grave. And as every desperate day, they tend to come unexpectedly. And there brings a fear and a trembling in the heart. It's kind of what we're going through now. I did not expect this year to have to deal with the reality of a pandemic, and that we're shut up and separated the way we are. And I am grateful. Let me just say again, I'm grateful for our president. I'm grateful for our governor. Midway Baptist Church is, as they call it, social distancing, but that's our decision. As a good shepherd to protect his flock, the government did not step in and tell this church, you have to close. I want you to hear me. If they did, I would not have agreed to that. But I'm grateful for the protection that this country provides to worship. And we want to be sane and sensible and pleasing to the Lord and honorable to the government in all that we do. So I say a great thank you. And my hope is that we will be together soon, much sooner than later. So let's jump into text this morning as we come to celebrate that Jesus Christ is the resurrection and the life. In chapter 11, we begin reading in verse 1. Now a certain man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. And it was that Mary who anointed the Lord with fragrant oil and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore, the sisters sent a message to Jesus, saying, Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick. Think of it like a prayer. Lord, not just the one I love, but the one you love is sick. And when Jesus heard that, verse 4, he said to those around him, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he had heard that he was sick, here's what Jesus did. He stayed 2 more days in the place where he was. I want you to come with me. I want you to don't make the mistake and say, you know what? I know how the story ends, because you're going to miss the force of what's taking place. And you're going to miss a great purpose in the message. They did not know how it would turn out. They did not know the events that were going to follow. What they did know was that their brother got sick. He was sick unexpectedly, very quickly. It came on. He wasn't old. He wasn't infirmed. But he was sick. And they were tending him and watching over him. There's a challenge to watching over those we love when they become so ill. It rips your heart. There is a rending in your soul that takes place. And Jesus stayed and did not rush over there. Then I want you to watch. Not only was it a desperate day, but it led to a dead man. Look at verse 14. And Jesus said to them plainly, Lazarus is dead. Jesus waited until Lazarus was dead. Now, Jesus had raised others by this time. Look, the Gospel of John is unique. From chapter 12 on is 1 week of time. Not a year, 1 week. And so this is right as things are going to be tilting and moving. Jesus had raised 2 other people from the dead. Do you remember? He raised a little girl who had been dead only a few moments. And he came, and I think the words can be translated, little princess, awaken, and he took her hand. The second time, another one, was a young man, not sure of his age, but he had been dead for hours. And the procession passed by for the burial, and Jesus called him back. And now we come to Lazarus, and we're going to find that Lazarus, by the time Jesus shows up, has been dead 4 days, went through the illness, and is now dead. I want you to hear me something. Just the reality of this world is not heaven. Everybody gets dead. Everybody gets dead. The key is, I want to, when I die to the glory of God. Each one of these, each of these three, were equally dead. The condition of decay and corruption was different. Same thing with us in sin, beloved. The Bible says the soul that sins, it'll die. I'm dead in my sins. The most wretched, vile, dripping, evil sinner. Not a respectable looking one, but the vilest is just as dead. We have different levels of corruption, but we all need life. This man comes, and Jesus wanted everyone to understand that Lazarus was not resting. Lazarus was dead. And so, what do you do with that? Well, watch what happens. We're going to move further down. Go with me. Go with me to verse 19. And watch what happens. Now Jesus came, verse 17. So when Jesus came, he found that Lazarus was already in the tomb 4 days. Lazarus had been buried. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles away. And many of the Jews had joined the women around Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him. But Mary was sitting in the house. Now Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Now I want to pause right there. That, I want you to notice, is her speaking her doubts and demanding an answer. She does it very gently. And don't be too hard on this lady, because many folks are asking the same question now. And the question is simply this to Jesus: where were you? Where were you? You said you loved us. Where were you? Why did this illness come? Why didn't you heal? We know you can heal. We've seen what you've done. Where were you? There's a disappointment that touches the heart. Now I want you to hear me and hear me well. You with me? Satan will always try to make the Lord Jesus the bad guy. You know you're in trouble, because the Lord is too wise to do anything foolish, and he's too loving to do anything cruel. There's always a purpose. There's a purpose in living, and there's a purpose in dying. But I look at this precious lady, and she expresses her past pain. This is the pain. This happened, and she's trying to make sense out of it, and she's being gracious. She's not screaming and cursing at Jesus. I've heard that nonsense. If you're mad with God, let him know. Curse. What idiot came up with that idea? God can take our questions, but we should always live in a fearful respect of Almighty God. Follow her lead. You see, she comes, and let me just show you. Let's look again. Martha, verse 21. Now Martha said to Jesus, because I think a lot of us are finding ourselves in the same place. Now Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you. And Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. And Martha said, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. What did she do? Ah, listen. Because here's the power of what's going to take place. She mentioned something that happened in the past. Where were you, Lord? I guess maybe we all wrestle with the thought that if I love the Lord and strive to please Him, that difficulties won't touch my life like everybody else. That's just not the way it works. And then she tries to explain herself, and she steps and she says, but we know that you're going to raise Him up in the last day. We know that. What did she do? What's her mistake? Not that she's wrong, but that her faith misses. And I believe this is part of the glory of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. She has a past disappointment, and she's looking and believing God that it's going to be better in the future, but she doesn't recognize Christ in the present, that He has the power now to turn a situation to His glory and our good. He looks at her, and she misses totally His power for the present. He says, your brother will rise again. And then she looks right past. You know, we do that. We pray for God to help, but we don't expect it as we should. If right now that Christ can change my life, your life, this situation for His glory. I don't mean we're going to get what we want, but we're going to find God's purpose in what God wants. And you know they had been talking together. Because if you come down, look with me at verse 32. Because Mary's been in the house crying, and the ladies are with Him. And now she goes out to meet Jesus, and they all follow her out. And here's what happens. Then when Mary came where Jesus was and saw Him, she fell down at His feet, saying to Him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. And therefore, when Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews which came with her weeping, He groaned in His spirit and was troubled. That's why we call Him Savior. He knows the journey that we walk through in this world is hard, and He cares. So we can cast all our cares upon Him because He cares for us, the Bible says. And He said, where have you laid Him? And they said to Him, Lord, come and see. And Jesus wept. I love my Savior. He cares. He understood that they were speaking their doubts, and they were as kindly as they could. They were angry with Him. If you would have been here, it wouldn't have happened. Meaning, you just weren't doing what you were supposed to do. You ever feel that way? That God's let you down? I believe there's a lot of people, they know they should be at church on Easter, but they don't go to church anymore because they battle with this reality right here. I wanted my marriage to work and it failed. I raised my children up in church and look what they've done. I understand that. I remember my dad when he got ill. And I talked to the doctor, and the doctor said that at best he had 4 months to live. And I went to our little home, and he met me at the door. He was in a wheelchair. And he looked at me, and he always called me buddy. And he said, you came back from the doctor. You came back from the doctor. He always spoke in French. And I said, yes, sir. I was a grown man. I had watched more people die than I want to remember. And he asked me, he said, okay, what did he say? I said, you ready? He said, man, what you gonna be if you're not ready? He couldn't understand. That was my dad. He just couldn't understand not being prepared. He said, it's bad? I said, yes, sir. I said, you have a disease. He said, ça c'est mauvais, that's bad, a disease. I said, yes. And then he looked at me and he said, it was June. He said, I know you're not gonna lie to me. And I said, no, sir, I'm not. He said, I'm gonna be here to plant my garden in the spring. I said, I don't think so. I don't think so. And he looked at me and I looked at him and we both nodded as men do when you've run out of words. And then he said, you want a sandwich? And I said, sure. And we made our way to the kitchen. And as we walked to the kitchen, as he went and I rolled him in the wheelchair, I was so grateful that a few years before that my dad had knelt down by the bed of my mom and gave his life to Christ. I understand Mary and Martha. It's hard for us in dark days and troubled times to not ask why, where were you? And yet, Jesus is never the problem. He's always the solution. Mary said, where are you? You go down to verse 37. And the ladies that were there said, could not this man who opened the eyes of the blind also kept this man from dying? Everybody just wanted to know why Jesus wasn't on the job. Guys, Christ's role is to grow us in faith, not to pamper our feelings. There was a doubt that demanded an answer, and they all asked it gently. But then that led everything to what Jesus said he thanked God for. Watch with me in verse 25 and 26. And Jesus said, right after Martha said, I know that he'll rise again in the resurrection on the last day. And Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? See, the declaration. Jesus said, those who believe in me will never die. Do you believe this? Now let's get something straight. The death that Jesus is talking about is what the Bible calls eternal death. First of all, there's the physical death. Physical death is when the soul leaves the body. Have you ever watched someone die in front of your eyes? It's not a machine shutting down. It's life leaving. That's physical death. That's this world. If a believer perishes, God's not punishing him. It is our destiny and our joy to go to heaven. Now, we're not lining up like nut jobs saying, I want to die today, but I'm ready to die today. That's why I'm telling to my church family, I want you to hear it. I'm not afraid to come to your home. If you're sick, we will come to you. Wherever you are, we are not afraid. That is our calling. That is our duty. We fear no darkness. So I want you to know that. As ministers, we don't run from the plague, we run to it. That is God's call. Not that we're special. With the call comes grace. That is who we are. Jesus came and he wanted them to understand. He said, I'm the resurrection and the life. Now, eternal death is separation of the soul from God. Physical death is separation of soul from the body. Eternal death, which continues forever in hell, is separation of the soul in hell from Almighty God for all eternity. And he said, I'm the life. To follow me, I'm going to lead you into a new life, a better life. Now, there may be some, and you're listening because it's Easter and you know you're supposed to. Okay? Listen up. There is a common grace of Almighty God. The common grace of God blesses all. Sunshine blesses all. Being able to taste and enjoy food, to be able to experience love, is the common graces of Almighty God. The life that Jesus offers magnifies past that. See, even a murderer can enjoy McDonald's French fries. Have you ever noticed that McDonald's French fries, and those people are smart. Because when they're hot and the grease is smelling, they seem so tempting. And then you eat them and you realize you were fooled. Although at first, when they're hot, they're mighty good. There's a declaration of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm the God of right now. Do you believe that? Do you believe I'm the resurrection and the life right now in your life? Right where we stand. That's where it is. That's what moves us to a commitment. Now, look at the delicate answer that she gives. And imagine Jesus is asking you, do you believe this? And she said to him, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God who has come into the world. Do you believe this? Yes, Lord, I do. I believe it. Her answer was correct. Listen close. Her answer was correct, but it wasn't complete. I believe. I just don't know if I believe what you could do right now. I don't know if you could save my soul right now, today. I don't know if you can change my life to your glory right now, today. And that's my hope for you this Easter, that you and I, as born-again believers, can step beyond the limitation of our belief into a greater walk with the Lord Jesus Christ. She had come to the end of where she could see. Jesus could handle the future. She wasn't sure what he could do right now. And beloved, it just came to decision time. What were they going to do? Look with me with we'll just keep going down. Verse 39, look what the Bible says. Now they've gone to the tomb. Martha's there. She asked her question, where were you? Mary's come. The crowd's there. And Jesus has cried over their sorrow, and he comes to the tomb. Verse 38, then Jesus again, groaning in himself, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone laid against it to close it. And Jesus said, take away the stone. And Martha, the sister of him who was dead, said to him, Lord, by this time there's a stench, or as the King James says, he stinks, for he has been dead 4 days. What happens? That was as far as she could go. You see, when times of trouble, when times of discouragement, when times of distress, when times of disease touch our bodies, there reaches a place where you and I are going to come to the limit of our walk with Christ. It doesn't mean that I don't love Him. It doesn't mean that I'm not a believer. What it does mean, I'm walking into territory beyond the size of my God that I understand. I need a faith bigger than I had. I've reached a limit. Hers was simply this. He's been dead 4 days, and he's starting to decay. The Jews had a superstition, we understand, that for 3 days, the spirit could dwell around the body, and maybe the person will wake up. But by 4 days, they're rotting. And she looks and she says, don't do it. He stinks. It's too far gone. We all reach a limit where we are faced that our faith stops. And Jesus opens our eyes that He can move us forward. Troubled times always reveals the level of our faith. And then Jesus said, verse 20, did I not say to you that if you would believe, you would see the glory of God? What does it take to see the glory of God today? What's in your situation? I understand social distancing and you're trying to keep away, but if you're hiding in an abnormal fear, you need a fresh eyes on Jesus. Your situation has become beyond what God could touch. In your eyes, you need a new look. Because our sin and our situation is never more powerful than our risen Lord. And my part is not to get God to change my circumstances, but I want to be changed by God in my circumstances. I believe in miracles, but we trust in Jesus. So what does it take to see the glory of God? Jesus said right here, did I not say that if you would believe, you would see the glory of God? Are you willing to trust? Belief is not saying yes in my head, it's trusting in my walk with Christ. And verse 41, and then they took away the stone from the place where the dead man was buried. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. And I know that you always hear me. But because of the people who are standing by, I said this, that they may believe that you sent me. What's the purpose of the miracle? Is that we would believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Now, when he had said these things, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he who had died came out, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was wrapped with a cloth. And Jesus said to them, loose him and let him go. See, there was decision time. What do you believe? And then there became the power of Jesus Christ in the presence, and it changed everything. We see deliverance. They moved the stone out of the way, and Jesus called for him to come forth. Now, get the picture. He's all wrapped. He's wrapped like a mummy. How did he come out of there? I don't know. Did he hop out? Did he roll out? Did he float out? I don't know. But let me tell you, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And Lazarus heard the call. And Jesus raised him up. And he came out wrapped in the relics of his death, bound up in those rags. Beloved, I want you to hear me right now. Because my prayer is that today, this morning, that there are those who are going to trust Jesus for the very first time. That same Jesus has declared that we are dead in trespasses and sins. And the only way we can receive life and forgiveness is through him. And that today you will call upon him like the thief on the cross and make him your Lord of your life. But I want you to hear me. Both to those who are going to be saved today and those who are saved. The Bible says that we are to grow and to be discipled and be conformed to the image of Christ. What does that mean? That's why churches exist. It was God's purpose. That we come and we worship together and let the world see our love for Jesus. But even beyond that, that we grow in the Word of God, for the Spirit of God gives life to the Scriptures, and the Scriptures change me. It gets rid of stinking thinking in my head, the old rags of my old life, the way I used to see things, the way I was, start to go away. That's why Jesus said, loose that man. Take that off of him. Ah, beloved, a Christian without a church home is an orphan in this world. Jesus said, unwrapped him. We get unwrapped by growing in the truth, because the truth will set you free. Now, Lazarus is raised. You would think everybody would be excited. Man, he is saved. A lot of people were, but the Pharisees were not. And if you go down to verse 53, the Bible says, then from that day on, they plotted to put Jesus to death. It was determined. Man, listen, we can put up with a Jesus who's like all the other gods. We can put up with a Jesus who's like everybody else. But a Jesus who transforms sinners, the one and only, the only way to God, no, sir, we can't tolerate him. And the world still can't tolerate him. But he's still the way for sinners, for men and women, boys and girls, to know the love of the Father, to be transformed in their lives. And as we come and we begin to move this message to a close, chapter 12 says this, verse 1, then 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany. He left. He didn't go on a tour carrying Lazarus around. Hey, look at him. Jesus comes back where Lazarus was, who had been dead, whom he had raised from the dead. And there they made Jesus a supper, and Martha served. But Lazarus was the one of those who sat at the table with him. Now we find them dining. Listen to me. Once you find Jesus and his blessings and his power in the present, all our past disappointments are gone. All the questions were gone. All the anger with Jesus was gone. I believe that we always find that. When we get to heaven, you ever heard people say, when I get to heaven, I'm gonna want to find out why my son died. Brother, if you get to heaven, you're going to see how glorious your son is and how wonderful our Savior is, and those things won't matter because we'll understand. Oh, I see them fellowshipping. The disappointment was gone. So what are we going to do with this message today? Jesus Christ is the resurrection and the life. He proved what he said by his own resurrection. See, there are some, and hear me, you've grown up in church, but you're lost. If you were to die today, hell would be your eternity. Brother Dennis, how can you say that? Well, let's base it on a couple of things. Has your life been changed? Do you have a commitment to follow the words of Jesus? Do you have a desire that the Holy Spirit gives to experience life among other believers? This whole part of, well, I can be a Christian and never go to church. Find me a verse in the Bible to back that up. It's nonsense. It's nonsense. Oh, to be churched and to be lost. You see, believing faith, beloved, is more than celebrating Easter with some Instagram slogan or some Facebook facade and amazing phoniness that I get these little clips and I can be whoever I want. See, the real life that Jesus gives is I find that my sins of my past are forgiven. And I need that. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, me and you. That what Jesus gives me now is a new affection in my heart. There are things that I love that I never would have dreamed. I love celebrating Christ in the church. Why? Because Jesus made the church. It's his bride. It's weird. Hey, I love Jesus. I hate the church. That's like you telling me, you know, Brother Dennis, I really like you, but I can't stand your wife. How that's going to work? Kind of goofy talk. See, finding Christ, I find forgiveness of my sins. I find a change that he works in my heart, and he continues working and setting me free. And the Holy Spirit fills my life with God's purpose. I'm not just a rat in a rat race. I'm not just trying to survive. That there's a purpose to my life. That all things work together for the good for those who love the Lord. All things. And who are called according to His purpose. All things. Sad things. Saintly things. Sinful things. Sickness. They all go into the crucible of God's hand. And He mixes them together. And it fills his purpose in my life with love. So we've come this morning to glory in the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you know him? He can handle your past. He is the God who has heaven as our home. But he is the resurrection and the life at this moment. He's the one who can save now. For today is the day of salvation. Would you come? Would you call to him right now? Would you say, Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner and I need you. I need you to save me, to come into my life, to be my Lord, to be my King. Lord, I'm not sure what all those words even mean, but I believe you are who you've said you are. And all I know of me, I'm given to all I know of you today. You said you'd save me, and I'm calling upon you to do that. Call me out of the grave of my sin into a new life. There's some Christians, because of some disappointment that you've had, you're still sitting in the graveyard of your grief. It's time to step out and follow Christ into the land of the living. You won't be disappointed. Not with Jesus. Will you come? May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you. May his glory shine upon your home and your life. And may the Lord use you to shine in a dark day. God bless each and every one of you.